Oh, no, that's what I call service. I promise, I'll keep it straight. What the heck? For those of you that are brand new, that was not Jesus. You know, start rumors on us now. It's just fun to be in the house of God, isn't it? I've been bugging him about doing that for the longest time. You know, Pastor Luke started it on a Sunday morning. He came out that way, you know, and it was like, that is so fun, you know. And then someone from the administration office sent out a letter and said, we can't do those things. Someone might get hurt. And I said, well, you know, we don't care if they get hurt. We'll pray for them. I want them to come out that way. So I've been talking him into that. That looked pretty good. I hope you saw that. And it's just great. Real quick, you know, I'm just so proud of Pastor Luke. He is coming back tomorrow night. And the interesting thing about this trip to Israel is the second one in a few months. And this one, he's like, he blew him away. For those of you who went on the first trip, this one was 100 times more impacting in his life. And he made a statement because he's just being treated in such a way that is amazing. He's going places that most people can't even go. The government of Israel is financing his trip there. And he met with a defense minister and people like the mayor of Jerusalem and all these things. And I don't know, maybe he's getting ready to take some of you to Israel next year, but what a trip that's going to be. And it is, it's going to be really outstanding. Mom and I went there when we were there a number of times, took tours years ago. And I have to tell you, it's like, my goodness sakes, it's like going home. And when you leave, you just don't want to leave. And that's where he's at right now. He says, I want to come home, but I don't want to come home. I mean, it's just such an amazing experience. And so pray for him, and you'll enjoy him this. I don't think he's ministering this weekend, Pastor. Pastor Wonderful Dan is, but Luke's probably Sunday night, no? Next Wednesday night? Which I'm, whatever, I don't know. Are you ready for the word of the Lord? Okay, before we pray, before we do anything, I have to talk to you just a little bit. You know, if you don't pay attention tonight, then you're going to really miss out. You're not going to like this message at all. This is one of those messages you have to concentrate. I believe in you. I believe you're smart enough that you can concentrate and don't have to let your minds wander and think about other stuff. Be somewhat disciplined in what you hear. Because if you aren't disciplined in what you hear, you really don't get anything out of it. And you drive home and you say to yourself, well, you know, that really didn't relate to me, or that stunk. And truly, God was saying something to each and every one of us that are in here tonight. I think it's an amazing thing that God wants to share with you tonight. And so, but it's going to take something in your part to really be attentive. I'm going to use a lot of words. I'm going to talk a lot. And I'm going to share things from one verse to the other verse. And if you're not listening, you're going to miss this. The other night, I think it was last night, Debbie and I were watching a television show. BBC has Sherlock Holmes, and we were watching one of the Sherlock episodes, and, you know, my age, I just fell asleep on the couch about halfway through. And Debbie, usually she brings me up to speed on that, but she fell asleep too. And what happens is when we both woke up, we finished watching it, and then we both looked at it and said, man, that was a terrible Sherlock Holmes. That was horrible. And the reason for it being horrible is because we were half asleep and didn't get it. And so tonight, with that in mind, don't fall asleep. Slug yourself in the face if you have to stay awake. And get the things that God has for you tonight, because we're going back once again to the profound words of Jesus, which I think is amazing. Matthew, the 16th chapter. And let's pray. Matthew 16th chapter, profound words of Jesus. Father, here we are. We haven't come into this place in the name of Jesus to hear from a man or a woman. We haven't come to hear from a white man or black man or brown man or whatever, Lord, a tall man, short man. We haven't come in to hear from anybody except the teacher of the church, who's the Holy Spirit. Lord, we're wise enough to know that you use men to communicate your truth. And Father, it's only in the anointing that that falls upon the heart and stays in the heart, so that we can be all that you would have us to be and do all that you would have us to do. We're in this place tonight, Lord, to make a statement. We love you. And we want what you want for us. And we want to learn what that is, because we have our own philosophies and ideologies and all that crazy thinking from the past. And we need you, Holy Spirit, to touch us, strengthen us, encourage us, guide us, guard us, direct us, motivate us, heal us to be what you would have us to be. And God, we'll give you the praise, give you the glory. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' mighty name. But Lord, we pray not only for ourselves tonight. That would be horribly selfish. We pray for the entire church, everywhere that meeting in the name of Jesus. Father, we bless our Baptist brothers and Lutherans and Methodists, Episcopalian, Charismatics, Pentecostals. Thank you for Calvary Chapels and Harvest and Oak Valley and all the great churches that are out there, the Well, the Way, all the churches. Lord, just bless them. Bless our Adventist brothers and sisters and Catholic brothers and sisters. Lord, at no time we at The Rock think of ourselves as better than them, but we see ourselves as co-laborers, workers together in one field, not building a man, but building the name of Jesus and the kingdom of God. Now, Lord, you're in charge of their churches and you're in charge of this church. Jesus, you're the senior pastor. And as you bless us here, we ask that you would bless them if they're gathering all over the world this night, our brothers and sisters also. Jesus' mighty name, with a great big shout, we all say, amen. Amen. Matthew, the 16th chapter, I'm going to read you 12 verses. I'm going to try to get through these 12 verses. Like I say, they can be a bit complex in understanding. Oftentimes what we do is we read and we read and we read and we keep on reading. And then we even are people who brag about how much we've read and how fast we've read, how many chapters we've got in a day. I have to tell you that I'm not a fan of that at all. I don't care how many times you read the Bible. If you don't get anything out of it, then you're wasting your time and you might be able to brag about it. But I like going slow and evaluating the eternal word of God. And I like looking at everything that's being said so that I can get the most out of it. I mean, it's like, you know, fast food. You're going to get it down. You're going to be satisfied. You're not going to be hungry. But, you know, it's not going to be necessarily good for you compared to healthy food that you take your time doing something with. And this is the same thing with the Word of God. So tonight, I want to encourage you one more time. Don't let yourself fall asleep and follow what I'm saying. I'm going to put it up on the over here. I'm going to share with you what's going on, what's being said. I'll read it through one time, 12 verses, and I'm going to come back to verse number one. And then you're going to see these profound words of Jesus and what they mean for you and what they mean for me. Now, stop before you go any further. This has been the Word of God, the Bible, preserved for thousands of years. And at the expense of many people's lives, a lot of blood has been shed over this Word of God so that you can have it in your lap right now. It is the inspired Word of God. The Bible refers to itself as the hidden mysteries of God. Hidden because they're hard to find, and mysteries because they're hard to figure out. That's why when you read your Bible and you go, oh, what does that mean? What does that mean? What does that mean? That's why we're here to explain to you what's taking place. And when you take these hidden mysteries of God and you apply them in your marriage, your home, your finances, dream vision, your business, whatever it might possibly be, oh my goodness, now you're really doing something. You're going to get blessed. And so with that in mind, let me start reading. Keep in mind, I'm coming back to verse number one and start to explain. You'll get an overview as I read, but then we'll come back to verse number one. Verse number one says in the 16th chapter of Matthew, then the Pharisees and the Sadducees came testing him. Notice the capital H in the word him, meaning Jesus. They're testing him. Asked that he would show them a sign from heaven. Verse 2. And he answered and said to them, remember, these are the profound words of Jesus. So this is the red letter stuff in your Bible. This you ought to be able to easily understand. Actually, it is very easy, but oftentimes we don't spend enough time to think about what we're reading. So Jesus answers and said to them, when it is evening, you said, it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning, it will be foul weather today, for the sky is red and threatening. Hypocrites, you know how to discern the face of the sky, but you do not discern the signs of the times. A wicked and adulterous generation seeks after the signs, and no sign shall be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. And he left them and departed. And when his disciples had come to the other side, they had forgotten to take bread. And Jesus said to them, take heed and beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. And they reasoned among themselves, saying, it is because that we had taken no bread. And Jesus, being aware of it, said to them, O ye of little faith, why do you reason among yourselves because you have brought no bread? Do you not yet understand and remember the 5 loaves of the 5,000 and how many baskets you took up? Listen to this, verse number 10. Nor the 7 loaves of the 4,000 and how many baskets you took up? How is it that you do not understand that I do not speak to you concerning bread, but beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees? Then they understood that he was not telling them to beware of the leaven of the bread, but of the doctrine of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Okay, when you read that, it doesn't say a lot. What if I stood before you tonight and said, this is monumental in your life? This that I just read to you is going to ring your bell. Probably like a lot of people have never had their bell rung in church yet. And this is really powerful stuff. Verse number 1, let's look at it together. And it says, then the Pharisees and the Sadducees came testing him, asking him that they would, if he would show them a sign from heaven. And he answers them, when it's evening. Now, first of all, let me say this in verse number 2. Debbie and I are sailors, and both of us know there's an old sailing slogan. It kind of goes like this, if I can remember it. Red skies at night. No, come on, Mama, help me. Don't scratch your head. Okay, red skies at night. Sailor's delight. Red skies in the morning, sailors take warning. Did you know that was in the Bible? I didn't know that. Here it is. He's telling them, and he answers and says to them, when it is evening, you say, it is a fair weather, for the sky in the evening, watch this, is red. Did you know that you can look at the sky in the morning, tell you what the day is going to be like? Now watch this. The next part of that verse comes up, and he says this in verse number 3. And in the morning, it will be foul weather today, for the sky is red and threatening. Hypocrites, you know how to discern the face of the sky, but you cannot discern the signs of the times. And this statement right here makes so much. We can think about things as a human race and figure things out very naturally, but oftentimes we miss the spiritual insight that we need to have to understand what's going on around us. We oftentimes will look at the natural, be able to easily figure that out, like these people, or like a sailor on a ship at sea. But yet at the same time, God doesn't want you just to figure out the natural. He wants you to see into the spiritual as to what's going on. So immediately he confronts the scribes and the Sadducees and the Pharisees, and he comes to them and he says, look, you are missing the whole thing here. You guys are amazing. And he comes and he makes a statement to them and calls them a hypocrite. Hypocrite because they don't know how, now look at the verse again, to discern. Everybody say the word discern. Well, first of all, let's talk about this for a moment. To discern something is to be able to figure it out, is to be able to understand things. Many people go to church, they got a Bible in their lap, they've been going for years, but they still don't discern what they should discern. They still live in the natural, they still figure out things by the natural, but they miss the spiritual. And may I say this, you will never get directions that's properly by going to the natural. You got to learn how to operate in the spiritual. And here you find him calling them a hypocrite. A hypocrite is somebody who says one thing but does something else. A hypocrite is someone who portrays himself as one way. In this particular case, they portray themselves as spiritual, but yet at the same time, he calls them, you're not spiritual. You can't even understand the signs of the times. You're not spiritual because you miss everything. You're not spiritual because you fail in your faith. Let me say something. How they fail in their faith is they ask for a sign. Guess what? Give me a sign from heaven and then I'll believe. Did you know that's an awful lot like Christians in churches today? Let me see something. You know something? When you finally get to the place where you don't need a sign, you just know that you know that you know that you know that inside of you there's God. That's God. I don't care if I ever get a sign. I don't care if I ever see a miracle. He's still God in heaven. I don't care what anybody says. I don't care what anybody feels. I don't care what any of the world expresses. He's God in heaven and I'm following him wherever he goes, because faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things what? Not seen. Let me try that again. Faith is of the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things what? Not seen. So therefore they want to do what? See a what? Sign in order to get their faith, means they've missed God at where they're at. And guys, oftentimes we can be just that same way, that we miss the discerning power of the Holy Spirit that teaches us what to believe and what not to believe, what to see and what not to see. Discernment is very important for you and for I, that we discern the proper way. In fact, the whole thing about maturity, did you know that God wants you to grow to a place of maturity? So that you can get to that place, not where you're questioning God every time you turn the road or every time there's a problem or something happens, but that you simply know that's God. In fact, with that in mind, the word discernment or discern is an interesting word. Check it out, if you will, in Hebrews, the 5th chapter, last verse. Pop it up for me and we'll come right back to verse 3. And it says, but solid food belongs to those who are of full age, that is, those who by reason of use have their senses exercised. By reason of use have their senses exercised. By reason of use, by reason of use. In other words, you're using your senses to do something. Watch this. To discern both what is good and what is evil. And until you get to the place of discerning what is of the flesh and what is of the spirit, my friends, we will always stay immature when God wants us to grow up. Is anybody listening? And here you see these guys, these Sadducees and these Pharisees, and they are questioning Jesus to see what? A sign, because their faith has failed, and he calls them hypocrites because you look spiritual, but you aren't spiritual. And as soon as they open their mouth, he figured them out. Wow, I wonder how many times we open our mouth and he knows exactly where we're at. Now, that's an interesting thing that I started to talk to the Holy Spirit about this verse. This verse, if you will, notice the word hypocrite there. I don't know about you, but I think that's kind of a rude thing that he said to them. Would you agree with me or not agree with me? Here's Jesus confronted by these guys. They're the, if you will, church leaders. And how he's saying, you know, you can understand the natural things, but you can't even understand the signs of the times. You don't even know that I am the Messiah. You heard about the miracles. You've seen the word of God. You've seen nothing contrary to it. You know about Bible prophecies. You know what I'm doing, but yet you still now want to see a sign. And he comes along and he says, now, you hypocrites. Now, I'm just the kind of a guy that studies the Word of God and have for 40 years as a theologian that talks to God, talks to the Holy Spirit. I don't just go find out what somebody else said. God bless them. We love them. I want to find out what God says about things. And so I talk to God and I say, God, listen, I don't understand about this verse. Because, you know, Jesus is the one that says that we ought to do good to all of those, and especially those of the faith. Jesus is the one that says, you know, turn your cheek. Jesus is the one who instigated love in 1 Corinthians. Of course, Paul that wrote it, but it was the Word of God. It's Jesus. And he says, you know, that love believes the best. Love believes all things. How about this one? Love bears all things. And yet now, instead of we seeing love towards these people that are the religious leaders of the day, we see something different. We see Jesus saying, you hypocrites. How come? That doesn't even begin to make sense to any of us. It's like something contrary. Did you know that he called them publicly hypocrites so that you and I could learn a principle and a truth? Stop and think about it for a moment. If he just walked away and he said, oh, bless them. I'm believing the best for them. They're okay. Let's just do our thing. Don't be bothered by them. Did you know that you and I would never understand about the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees? And that's what he's talking about. In other words, he had to call attention to that which was supposedly spiritual that wasn't spiritual, so that we don't act spiritual when we're not, and we can do what he wants us to do, not the way man acts before other men. Is anybody listening? So here we see the contrasting personality of Jesus for the reason of expression. Now, because he said, you hypocrites, to these guys, and he calls them names, we now have our attention in these sections of words that say, wow, he is saying something to us. Let's go on. It's really fascinating. So verse number 4 comes on. And he says, a wicked, now he's not only called them hypocrites out loud in front of his disciples and in front of the Sadducees and the Pharisees. He's saying, hey, watch this. A wicked and adulterous generation seeks a sign. They just asked for it. They're there. And he makes a statement, a wicked and adulterous generation. You know, sometimes, my friends, we will read those words and not realize the depth of what he's saying. You see the word wicked up there? You ought to mark this next to your Bible. Wicked is the practice of evil. Evil is anything contrary to the ways of God. Let me say it to you one more time. Evil is anything contrary to the ways of God. I don't care if the Supreme Court says something and they determine it to be a law in our land. I don't care if the majority says this is the way it ought to be. I don't even give a flip if the church says this is what we ought to be. If God says it, that settles it. That's the way it ought to be. Anything that is, listen to this, contrary to the way and will of God is defined all through the Bible as evil. Now, when you make a mistake and you do something contrary to the ways of God, that's an evil mistake. But if you keep practicing, that's wickedness. Is anybody listening? And we know a lot of people in America that don't give a flip about God, that keep practicing ways that are contrary to God. And you know, the bottom line is they may fit in socially to our country. Guess what? But they are wicked because they keep practicing ways that are contrary. So when he makes this statement in verse number 4, he really pops the bubble of, as to no ifs, ands, or buts about what he's trying to do. This is a wicked and adulterous generation. Another thing that's kind of fascinating for us to look at, may I show it to you? You see the word adulterous all through the Bible. You're going to see about adulterers or adulteresses. And we think about someone who's married, going off, running away with somebody else, having a sexual relationship with someone else. And that's very true. That's an adulterous relationship. But it's not the relationship that Jesus is talking about. Any broken commitment is an adulterous relationship. When you make a commitment to God and you know who He is, but you decide not to keep that commitment to God, that's an adulterous relationship. And all through the Old Testament, you see Jesus called Israel many times as adulterous people who have ran off with some foreign god. Why? Because they made a commitment, they broke their commitment. Anytime you make a commitment, guess what? And you break that commitment, that's an adulterer in the scripture. Isn't that a wild thing? So you ought to be careful about where you make your commitments. Amen? Amen. Amen. You ought to be careful. I lost some of you on that one. You're not sure you like me now. But I'm telling you the truth. You ought to be careful about where you make your commitments. Because any commitment you make is an adulterous relationship before God. The Bible makes very clear that adulterous people will not make it to heaven. You don't want to be part of that. That's where the forgiveness, thank God, and the grace of God and the mercy comes in and takes care of us and washes us clean by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank God for that because I make a lot of mistakes and so do you. But guess what? We're learning how not to make them. And when we make a commitment, we're learning how to keep the commitment. Is anybody listening? So he makes this sum, adulterous and generation seeks after a sign and no sign, and this is fascinating to me, no sign shall be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. What was the sign of the prophet Jonah? 3 days in the belly of the whale. Whose 3 days in the tomb? Was Jesus. Rose from the dead after 3 days. If the greatest sign there is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. If you can't believe that, I wouldn't care if they came back from the dead right here. You will eventually be an adulterous person who says, I believe it, and then walk away from it. Because the bottom line for all of us, the greatest sign is his death, burial, and resurrection. Come on, somebody. And so he says, there's no sign I can give you except the very best sign, that of the prophet Jonah. He was 3 days in the belly of a whale and then was spit out on dry land. That's bizarre. But guess what? With Jesus, he is now dead in the tomb, crucified. And on the third day, you ought to shout right there. This is where I go like this. What's the matter? Are you sleeping already? Let me try that again. And we're practicing now, okay? And on the third day, that's still not very good. But it's true. And he says, that's the only thing. And he left and he departed. When they depart, something happens. The subject, which is really fascinating, of the leaven. Leaven, let's talk about that. We're going to talk about it again in a minute, but I just want to share with you, leaven. Do you remember I'll get to the leaven in a moment. Watch this, if we will, in verse number 5, it says it like this. He says, now when the disciples came to the other side, they had forgotten. Everybody say forgotten. Forgotten. It's really important that you understand this word forgotten. Our biggest problem as humans is we forget. No matter what great things God has done for us, we have a tendency to forget those great things, and now we're always looking for something new today. Instead of realizing there was something great God did for us before. This word forgotten is big, and I'll show it to you in a minute in a little more detail. But watch this, if we will, in verse number 6. They have forgotten to take the bread. And Jesus said to them, take heed and beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. In other words, boy, he's now making a statement. Beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. He also says that later on in verse number 11 and 12. It's also described again. And it's an interesting understanding. Why did Jesus select these words? The selection of these words are not just something that he burped out because he ate a pizza. This guy knows the makeup of every human being. He's the creator of the heavens and the earth. All things are created by him, for him. He knows the beginning from the end. He's held it all together. And he uses specifically a word, leaven. He says, take heed, beware. Beware. When you read that word, it's there not just for them, it's there for you. And that's why reading these verses fast would absolutely be such a shame, never get the depth of this. Listen to this. Here's what this is all about. He selects, beware of the leaven. Now, leaven is something that we know of as yeast. And here's how it works. Pastor Deborah has taught us this many times, that yeast or leaven is something that they take to dough and they put it in, they knead it. They knead it in and they work that leaven in. And once that leaven is in, it never can come out. And what leaven does is a really fascinating thing. It's like a little miracle, if you will. Leaven is something a lot of people don't understand, or yeast is something that a lot of people don't understand, because now Jesus understands this, and he selects that word for a reason. Now watch this. Yeast, or leaven, is a single cell, if you will, fungus. A single cell fungus, a low life single cell fungus that gets into the dough, causes warmth and brings gas that explodes inside or rises or blows up the bread or the dough. If you didn't have the leaven in the dough, you would have what is called flatbread. And you've seen it many times. And flatbread is because there's no leaven in the bread. So when this single cell fungus gets worked in, it brings a heat and a gas that brings forth a puffing up, rising, if you will, of the dough. I don't know, but I think Jesus is pretty smart in selecting the word leaven and then using it in reference, if you will, to the scribes and Pharisees. What he might be saying, this is just me now, tell me if you think it's interesting, what he might be saying by selecting the word leaven is these guys are like a single cell amoeba trying to figure out God, and they've got heat on the inside that is hot air that brings gas. And so here are these, Pharisees and scribes who think they know everything, and they're a bunch of hot air of gas. Now, I kind of argued a little bit about this. I'm not sure. But, you know, Jesus is not stupid. And that's exactly the product and exactly what it does. And he says, beware of the leaven of these guys. They're full of hot air and gas, and they're acting like a single cell fungus. And yet they look so good. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? You know what I'm talking about, you know? It's like so cool. So the depth of this is like just astounding. So let's take a look at it from, if you will, verse number 7. In verse number 7, and here's his disciples, or they've gone away from the scribes and the Pharisees, the Sadducees and the Pharisees. They've gone away from him, and now they don't have any bread. Remember, they forgot the bread. I made you use the word forget there. They come, and in verse number 7, and they reasoned among themselves, saying, it is because we have taken no bread. What is because they have taken no bread? He said, I want you to beware of the scribes and the Pharisees, the leaven which goes into the bread, right? So they're associating in their own reasoning right here. Their own reasoning says, he said that to us because we forgot the bread. You know, I love reading about these disciples. They were so great, but they're like dumb as a sack of rocks at times. And which makes me feel really good, because I'm about as dumb as a sack of rocks too. And I know some of you are even dumber than a sack of rocks. And so, my goodness, you know, this should make us all feel pretty good, right? Because they have not figured it out yet. Are you listening? If the scribes and the Sadducees and the Pharisees are single cell fungus, I can't imagine what some of us are at times. So he says these words, and they reason among themselves. Verse 8, and then I'm going to come back to verse number 7 in the back room in a minute. And Jesus, being aware of it, said to them, "Oh, ye of little faith, why do you reason among yourself because you have brought no bread?" Now stop right there. Jesus immediately picks up on where they're going. And he says, "You of little faith." Man, you of little faith. What's little faith? Not believing God. What's little faith? Looking spiritual when you really don't believe in God, which is the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees that they are be aware of. And can I just say this to you? The greatest thing, may I take you back to verse number 7? Here was their mistake, which is our common mistake all the time. Let me see if I can read it to you. "And they reasoned among themselves." Reasoning means it's a gathering or a calculations. You gather the data and you come to a conclusion. That's reasoning. Does God not want us to reason? No, God wants us to reason. The most important word in this entire verse is word themselves. God doesn't want you to reason among other men. He wants you to reason with him. Are you listening? And when they got with other men, what they were doing is figuring out what the problem was by based on what other men were saying. You and I get together oftentimes with God, and we'll hear more from our aunt and our uncle, our best friends, the people down the street, or somebody else, instead of getting with God. And let's reason together with God. God, I want to know what people say. You want to know how I reason. But the bottom line is I want to reason with you. And I want to find out what you have to say about that, because then I can move in the right positive direction. Their biggest mistake is they made a decision without God being involved in it, only in their own human calculation. Where did that come from? The tree of knowledge of good and of evil. All the way back to the garden, second chapter, that's when man learned how to make decisions for himself instead of following God. And since then, God's been trying to get us back to making our decisions based on what he says instead of based on who we are. Is anybody listening? So the verse becomes really powerful, and Jesus straightens them out in verse number 8, and he makes this statement, which is like amazing. And Jesus, beware of it, being aware of it, what they said. He says, "Oh, you have little faith. Why do you reason?" And listen to these words. Why do you reason? He didn't say, why do you reason? There's nothing wrong with reasoning. Everybody reasons. He said, why do you reason among yourself? Twice in two verses, you see that it's being pointed out to you and I. When you reason, don't reason. Debbie and I get up in the morning, we solve all the problems of the world. I mean, I don't care what, we have, in our life, you know, being in our, I'm in my 70s, she's in her late 60s, and guess what? And here we are, we have plan number 8,765,000,000. I wonder what would happen if we just stopped and stopped reasoning between, oh, you like that? I like that too. You like that? You like that? I like that. If you like that, you like that? I like that. Yeah, and we're trying to reason all the time. Stop reasoning among yourselves and start getting God in your reasoning. Is anybody listening? Among yourself, because you have brought no bread. That's not what I was, here's what that verse really translates. That's not what I was talking about, dummies. That's not a biblical translation. That's my paraphrase. Okay, so I know. So don't email me and tell me I'm a heretic. Go find another church. Verse number 9, watch this. Do you not yet understand or remember? Remember, I had you do two things last time we were together. We talked about profound words of Jesus, but in this particular case, two things are very important. That's what we're doing tonight. Understanding and learning how to remember. Because understanding is one thing, remembering is vitally important. Remember how I had you say, remember? I had you say, they forgot, right? Remember you all said, you forgot? And you all said, forget? Well, if you're not remembering, you have what? Forgot. two things God wants us to do. Wants us to understand and wants us to remember. Let me tell you how hard it is. How many of you have ever taken a test when you were in school? Do you remember how many of you today could take that same test and pass? No, come on, be honest with me. You're in church and you know liars don't fry. Liars fry, they go to hell, man. So the Bible makes it very clear. So be honest with me. I mean, how many of you think some of those tests that you took way back when you could take today and still pass them? For hardly any of us. Some of you, but you're only 12. And so how many tests? For us that are up, I don't even remember the school, let alone the test. You know, it's been so long. Did they have schools? You know, I don't even remember going to school. And so he wants us. So we have this human understanding of forgetting all the time. And that's one of the worst things that could happen to us. Let me show you something that's really kind of fascinating. Scripture in the Old Testament, Deuteronomy. Let me take you to Deuteronomy, the 6th chapter. And we're going to look at verses 10, 11, and verse number 12. Is that all right? But let me read to you this. Here's God speaking to Israel. And he's really making a statement. A statement that is for you. So you listen up, okay? You got to get this picture. He says, so it shall be that when the Lord your God brings you into the land in which he swore unto your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. What's he swearing to them? What's he going to do for them? Watch this. I think you'll find it fascinating. To give you large and beautiful cities in which you did not build. I mean, wait a minute, God. I'm trying to just get by. I'm broke. You know, I don't know. I don't have, I only... Well, here's the will of God for the people. To give you large and beautiful cities that you didn't even have to build it. And then the next verse, verse number 11, watch this. He says, houses full of good things. Oh my goodness. Sometimes I meet people and I say, God's blessing my business. And I'm so ashamed. I said, why are you ashamed? God bless your business. Because there's so many poor. Jesus said you'd had poor among you all the time. Don't forget them. Here's what's important to know and understand that God wants to prosper you in every area of your life. Who wrote that? I didn't write that. If I wrote that, I'd be collecting the royalties from that book. I'd be really, really, really rich. I didn't write this. This is God speaking here in the Bible. He said, a house full of good things in which you did not fill. He says, hewn out wells in which you did not dig, vineyards and olive trees in which you did not plant, when you have eaten and are full. God wants you to enjoy those things. And when you're full, here's what God wants. He doesn't care about anything else. Make one thing. Watch this. In verse number 12, he says these words. He says, so, verse number 12, then beware. How many of you heard the word beware before tonight? You heard it again. Here it is. And then beware, lest you forget the Lord. God wants to prosper you, but not if you're going to forget him. And that's what we're doing here. We're training so that we can get God prosper us, bless us, so we don't forget him. Is anybody listening? He brought us out of the land of Egypt and the house of bondage. So here we find that forgetting is not something new. We forget. And then we ask for a sign all the time because our faith is weak. God, show me if this, I want you to do this right now. I remember times Debbie and I had when we were first married that God did miracles in our lives. And today I forget those things. And I say, okay, God, I'm under this stress and I need this answer right now. Show me to me right now. And you know, that's wrong because what I'm doing is I'm lacking in my faith. My faith has failed and I'm looking for a sign to get my faith back up instead of looking to God to get my faith back up. Yeah. Is anybody listening? And so that's what the leaven of the Pharisees was all about. The leaven of the Pharisees was all about their failed faith. They look good on the outside, but on the inside of their heart, they didn't have it. Is anybody listening? Verse number 10. He says, verse number 9, he says, don't you remember the five thousand people, the five loaves? Remember when he fed all the multitude? And then he gives them another. He says, you forgot about the seven loaves, verse number 10, and the 4,000. How many large baskets did we take up afterwards? Now, food's not a problem. I'll get you food. I'll have it drop from heaven like manna. Whatever it might possibly be, I get you food. We had nothing, and I fed all thousands of people two times, but you forgot. And now you need something else. And you're trying to, because your faith has failed, it's the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Verse number 11 comes along. It says this, how do you not understand that? I did not speak to you concerning bread, but beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and scribes. Then they understood that he did not tell them to beware of the leaven of the bread, but of the teaching or doctrine of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. The interesting word here, teaching, doctrine. See the word doctrine? It means teaching. But beware of the teaching. Why? Because they taught spiritual principles naturally instead of spiritual principles spiritually. Do the rule. It's a natural thing. Do the way. It's a natural thing. Do the regulation. Do the tradition. All natural ways of approaching God that doesn't get you where you need to be. It's in the spiritual. And that was the key to this whole thing. And their teaching absolutely would stagnate the people with God because it was a bunch of rules, regulations, traditions, ceremonial rituals that never got the people where they never needed to be because their faith failed, so they always needed a sign. Let me tell you tonight, you don't need a sign. You got the King of Glory living on the inside of you. You got the one who's the creator of all the heavens and the earth living on the inside of you. The one who holds the moon at its right axis so the oceans don't flood the land and holds the sun at the right distance so we don't burn up or we don't freeze. He's the one that creates every breath we have that we take. It all belongs to him. Every heartbeat we have a beat because of him. My goodness, we don't need a physical sign on the outside. We've got a spiritual sign living on the inside of us. Come on, somebody. And when you forget that, you now become in the ranks of the Pharisees and the Sadducees who were the leaven, had leaven inside of them. Let's don't be people filled with hot air and gas from the single cell fungus that looks good on the outside, but on the inside we're as dead as doornails. That's 12 verses. Anybody get anything out of that today? Come on. Isn't that fun? Did you really? Well, if you got something out of it, then don't clap because I asked you to. I want you to open your mouth. Now listen, I'm talking spiritually right now. I want you to open your mouth. You give God a clap offering, that's what they did in the Old Testament, and a shout offering to the teacher who is the Holy Spirit. Because he's in here tonight, and I'll show you in just a moment even more, so don't move. But I want you to use your hands and your mouth to thank the Holy Spirit for that truth, and then ask him to keep it on the inside of you. Come on, give him a shout. Thank you, Jesus. Isn't that good? Wow, now that's what I'm talking about. God is so good. I want to make sure everybody's all right with God. The Spirit of the Lord is in this house right now. Nobody leave. If you go outside, I'm going to commission all of the ushers to beat the crap out of you in the foyer. So you say, oh, pastor, you said crap in church. Yeah, stop watching television if that offends you. So let's don't be hypocrites, okay? And you're watching a whole lot more than that. Listen to me. Everybody stay seated. Some of your lives are at stake in this house tonight. You know what you're crying out to? You don't know that you're doing this, and you don't know that you're saying this. This generation just says, tell me the truth. Don't play games with me. Don't blow smoke all over me. Don't throw candles all over me and catch things on fire. Tell me the truth. And I'm going to tell you the truth right now. Some of you are not going to like what I'm going to say, but I'm going to tell you the truth. You're going to die and go to hell. Some of you in this room, and you don't like that, but I can show you a way you don't have to die and go to hell, that you can have eternal life with Jesus, but it's going to take something on your part. Listen to me. First thing the Bible says oftentimes is to check yourself out. Really where you're at. Make sure you're okay with God. Did you know he says that numbers of times? You ought to check yourself out from time to time to make sure you're okay with God. Because why? We forget and then we fall back. So I want to ask you a question, and it'll tell you exactly where you're at with God. All you have to do is answer the question in your heart. Nobody will know but you and God. Is that okay? Nobody will know. All you have to do is answer the question in your heart. Here's the question. If you were to walk out of this building tonight and head towards your car and your heart stopped, bang, and you died, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? That's the question. Answer the question. If you died in the next few minutes, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? Some of you said, let's talk about your answer because it tells you right where you're at. Some of you said, well, I think I'd go to heaven. I think, Pastor Jim, I'd go to heaven. Can I tell you something? Nowhere in the Bible does it say you can think your way into heaven. Like whoever's the most positive thinker gets to go to heaven. You're not going to make it. And somebody needs to love you enough. Watch this. Watch this. Respect you enough. Honor you enough to tell you the truth and stop playing games. You can't think your way into heaven. Some of you said, well, my answer was, I hope I make it. Can I tell you there's nowhere in the Bible, it's not in the Bible, that says you can hope your way into heaven. Like, I hope. You're not going to make it, man. Somebody needs to tell you. Some of you said, well, you know, I think I'm going to go to heaven because I'm a pretty good person. Can I tell you something? Nowhere in the Bible, it's not in the Bible, that says because you think you're good enough, you're going to make it. Did you know most Americans' answer to why they're getting to heaven is because they think they're good enough? Somebody please read the Bible. There's nowhere in the Bible that says because you're good enough you get to go to heaven. You're not going to make it if you think you're getting there that way. Some of you say to yourself, well, wait a minute, Pastor Jim. Hold on, man. I want you to know that I've always thought of myself as a Christian. In fact, my parents took me to church when I was a kid. You know, I wasn't Jewish. I wasn't a Muslim. I wasn't a Hindu. I wasn't a Buddhist. I was born in America, ate apple pie, drove a Chevy car. Of course I'm American, and of course I'm a Christian. Can I tell you something? Nowhere in the Bible does it say your parents can tell you you're a Christian and you get to go to heaven because you're a Christian. Did you know that? You say, wait a minute, they had me christened when I was a baby or baptized when I was a baby, or they took me to Sabbath school class when I was a child. I'm glad they did, but that will not get you into heaven. Somebody needs to tell you the truth. You say, oh my, Pastor Jim, you don't understand. I joined my last church. Man, it was a great church. I was a helper to the pastor. I taught classes there. I counted the offerings. I carried the pastor's Bible. Doesn't that count for something? I think I'm going to heaven. I was part of that church. I was a member of that church. Could you show me where you become a member of a church, carry the pastor's Bible, teach Bible study at that church, you get to go to heaven? Because it's not my Bible, and I know it's not yours. You say, well, wait a minute, Pastor Jim, you just don't understand. I sang in the choir at that church. Will you show me where, because you sang in the choir, you get to go to heaven? You're not going to make it. Somebody needs to tell you. Now listen to what I'm saying to you. Tonight, your eternal life is at stake because I'm going to tell you the truth. Jesus makes this statement, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except his way. That's what he said. You can't get there your way. You can't get there my way. And you can't get to heaven some well-meaning church committee's way. You got to get to heaven his way. And in John, the third chapter, he tells us how to get to heaven his way. He said these words, you must be born again. You must be born again. If you're not born again, you may have a mind for God and you'll always operate in the natural instead of the spiritual. You must be born again. What's born again? Let me explain it to you so you can understand what born again is. If you must be this, at least understand what it means. Most people don't know throughout American churches. From the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, being born again means this, that you have given God all of your heart and given God all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. Somebody needs to tell you the truth. It always has been all or nothing. It always will be all or nothing. God forgive us in American churches that we've watered that down because we're afraid of people. And for 250 years, we've not told you the truth, but I'm telling you the truth. It's all or nothing. And I'll prove it to you by the scripture. Last book of the Bible, the book you know of, book of Revelation. Jesus is speaking. He says, I'm coming again, and you know he is. And he says, when I come, is what Jesus said, I better find you hot or I better find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. I'll vomit you from my mouth. Do you know what he just said in that rude little statement? He said these words, people who think they're Christians that are not born again are not real Christians at all. And they're going to get vomited from the mouth of Jesus when he comes. Why? Because it's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. How do you get there? You must be born again. You must give him all of your heart. You must give him all of your life. Listen, he's not going to rob your heart and life from you. He's not a thief. He's not going to talk you out of it. He's not a conniver. He's not going to hit you in the head with a 2x4 and make you do it. Trust me, he could do that, but he doesn't. What he does is gives you a free will choice, and that's who he wants in heaven, people who want to be in heaven with him. A free will choice to choose with all of your heart to give it to him and all of your life to give to him and not forget and not turn back and not to be a hypocrite. You'll make mistakes, you'll fall, you'll fail at times, but you just run back to him and he washes and cleanses you. And tonight, here you are in this safe and friendly place. We've laughed. We've heard the word. You are great listening to the Bible tonight. My goodness sakes. Don't walk out of here in a carnal way, a manly way, a natural way when the Spirit of God is calling you home. Tonight is your night of salvation. And you need to come and give your heart and life to Jesus. And all across this auditorium, I'm going to give that invitation to you right now. All across this auditorium, with your heads up, and your eyes open, this is something you should be proud of. And I want you to hear me. In a moment, I'm gonna count to three. I'll go like this. 1, 2, 3, bang! When you hear that sound of my hands, 1, 2, 3, bang! Your hand goes up. I'll see your hand. No, Jesus said these words. Listen to what he said. He said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. But if you deny me, I'll deny you. All across this auditorium, when you hear this, bang, your hand goes up and I'll see it. And what you're saying is, I want to give Jesus all of my heart, give him all of my life, be born again, headed for heaven, and denying my presence in hell. I don't want to go to hell. And I'll see your hand go up. Who should raise their hand if you've been running from God? Instead of to God, I'm speaking to you. If you've never given him all of your heart, never given him all of your life, I'm speaking to you. If you're one of those people that are in here and you're not sure, make sure. Maybe you prayed with Billy Graham or a Harvest Crusade. Hey, that's great. But where does it say a magical abracadabra formula called a prayer gets you in heaven? Can I tell you something? You can pray and you're blue in the face, but if your heart's not in it, you're not going to be right and you won't be born again. God looks at the heart. doesn't just hear the words of your mouth. Words are cheap. Tonight, here you are. Maybe you need to get your hand up and get right with God. I'm going to count to three. Don't let anything disturb you. Don't let anything disturb you. Don't let anything disturb you back there. Don't let anything stop you. Tonight is your night of salvation. And you almost got taken away by that. I'm counting to three. Get ready. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. There's one. Thank you. There's two. Thank you. There's three, four, five, six, seven. Thank you. Back over here. There's eight. There's nine. Thank you. There's 10 back over here. There's 11 right over on this side over here. There's 12, 13, 14. Thank you. Anybody else real quick? There's 14 people. Anybody else real quick? Anybody else real quick that you need to get your hand up? There's about 14 of you. Where's 15? 15, where are you? 15, where are you? Okay, we're going to jump over 15. Where's 16? Okay, 16. I like numbers. 16. Where are you, 15? Back over here somewhere. I think I already counted you, didn't I? No? Maybe? No? Did you just get it up just now? Cool. Okay, great. 17. God bless you. Anybody else real quick? Anybody else? There's 17 wise people. Wise, wise, wise. Anybody that knows they need to get their hand up and is not getting your hand up, sack of rocks. It's time for you to get your hand up. Anybody else? Thank you. 18. God bless you, my friend. Didn't embarrass them, I won't embarrass you. Where's 19 and 20? If someone says, boy, pastor, you really coerce people to come and get saved. I do. When the devil stops coercing you not to get saved, I'll stop coercing people to get saved. The devil's working overtime on you right now not to get your hand up. And you're listening to him. Who needs to get their hand up? Where are you? 19 and 20. Anybody else? Anybody else? One quick thing right through. This is it. This is it. You're going to miss out. Anybody else? There's 19. Thank God for you, because that way I'd go for 20. Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? I was about ready to cut it off. Anybody else? There's 20. God bless you. I see you. Let's give the Lord a great big praise. All right, watch. All of you that raised your hand, all of you that raised your hand, listen to me now. I'm going to give you some instruction. Get hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, friend. Get yourself a friend. If you need a friend, if you're sitting next to somebody, nudge them and say, come on, I'll go with you if you need to go. I want you to get out of your seat. And I don't want anybody to leave during this period of time. I'll let you go in a minute. We're going to stand up in a minute. We're going to give you a hand. Get your stuff. Get a friend. And meet me right here in front. Now, wait a minute. Here's another instruction. If you didn't raise your hand, but you know you should have, you can come too. So let's stand and welcome them as they come and give their lives to Jesus. Come on. Give the Lord a great big praise for them. All of you, all 20 of you, get up here.
Surrender all.
Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on.
And I surrender all unto thee, my
come on.
Savior, I surrender.
They're coming, give me a hand as they come.
Oh,
come on, they're coming.
I surrender.
Oh, they're coming, give me a hand as they come.
Oh, and I surrender all.
They're still coming, give my hand.
To thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender.
It's God good. There's more than 20 of you up here. Like 30 of you. I'm glad you came. Put a smile on your face. It's a good thing, not a bad thing. It's like you're not going to a morgue, you're going to heaven, my goodness sakes alive. That ought to make you happy, man. Best thing you ever did. Now, real quick, this is my friend, Pastor Joel. He's going to pray with you, give you some free stuff about what to do next, introduce you to a program we have called Spiritual Personal Trainers. You're personal trainers? You know what a personal trainer is? In a gymnasium, they'll help you get all pumped up in a gymnasium. That's a personal trainer. But guess what? These are spiritual personal trainers. They'll meet you before church service, you know, pray for you during the week, buy you tacos, cheese, burritos, lobster, steak, whatever it takes to get you back to church. And then they'll go through scripture with you all the time. So it's kind of fun. We're introducing, we give away friends here, and that's called spiritual personal trainers, and they'll help you for the next 5 weeks, and it'll be just absolutely a blessing. God's got, listen to me, listen to me. God's got a future that if you stay with God, your tongue will jump out of your head and slap your brain. It'll be so good. I'm telling you, it is. Am I talking the truth around here? Does anybody know about the goodness of God? It is so good that's waiting. It's time. You've had enough junk in your life. Let's do God, man. It's going to be good if you'll do God. That's a promise. So make a left turn. Follow Pastor Joel right over there. Come on, give the Lord a great big praise. Woo!